Really great to be here. I think I'll start out and just tell a little bit about autism. It varies from Einstein, who had no language at age 3, to somebody who can't dress themselves. Over the years, doctors have kept changing the guidelines. It's maybe half science, and the other half is doctors squabbling in conference rooms in nice hotels like Marriott's and Hyatt's. Nobody's doing that with the diagnosis of tuberculosis. You can have a kid that's just normal, no speech delay, awkward, geeky kind of kid. You know, that's on the very mild end of the spectrum. I've been out to Silicon Valley. Half those programmers are on the spectrum. It's just that simple. Been to a whole bunch of those places. Now, I think a brain can be more thinking, or a brain can be more social-emotional. You know, some of that's just normal variation. And then you get enough geeky, and then maybe you label it mild autism. You get too much of the trait, you get a kid who can't dress themselves. See, it's a continuous trait with complicated genetics. What I want to do is talk to you about the educational system. You know, there's a lot of great innovators out there. What would happen to them today? Those people who are going into the educational system today. I am really concerned about that. So I'm going to just show you some people. I spent a lot of time reading a lot of biographies that had an unconventional educational path into a successful career. Let's take Jane Goodall, for example. I was really shocked to learn that she had a 2-year secretarial degree when she started her famous study. Would that happen today? She obtained her PhD without a bachelor's degree. Now, she also had some difficulty remembering faces. She kind of liked the solitude of the woods. What would happen to Jane today in today's educational system? How about Thomas Edison? He was a hyperactive high school dropout. His teachers labeled him as addled. There's his famous patent there for the light bulb. What happened to a kid like that today? How about Steven Spielberg? He was rejected from a top film school because he had poor grades. He was bullied in school and dyslexic. What would happen to him today? About Elon Musk. That's a very interesting book. He was always different in a slightly nerdy way. Severely bullied. You see, that's something that keeps coming up. I was bullied in high school. It was terrible. Now they can bully you online, which makes it even worse. And sometimes he appeared deaf. And that's one of the symptoms I had when I was a young child. I had no speech until age 4. I used to like pull out carpet fibers and study them. Thought that was really, really interesting. Well, what happened to him today? He actually came from South Africa. He had a lot of exposure to mechanical things in his father's shop. And as you know, he's been developing these rockets. Now, yeah, he did have some problems. And I was reading some of his some of the articles about the Tesla car company. You know what? Even if Tesla failed, he's succeeded. He's going to change the industry over to electric cars. I've been reading all the car stuff lately. But there's one thing that could make the electric cars fail. They better not have battery fires. Absolutely better not. When I came into Boston, replacement Samsung phone had just burned up on Southwest Airlines, and the ticket agent made it very clear that this Galaxy 7 was to not be turned on until it was far away from her aircraft. And that's the word she used. Yeah, they have a battery fire in these cars. It will deep six electric cars for a good long time. And I certainly don't want a phone that's going to burn up. I find that very, very scary. But there's a lot of things Musk has done right. He's greatly reduced the cost of rockets. Okay, what were some of the common denominators of these unique minds? What helped them to be successful? They grew up in an educated family. So even though Edison dropped out of school, he was in a house full of books. There was lots of books, all different kinds of things. They also had early exposure to career interests. Jane Goodall was out looking at chickens when she was 5 years old. She was reading all about chimpanzees and animals. The other thing all of these learned, they learned how to work hard at an early age. This is a big problem today with a lot of kids that are kind of quirky and different. They're not learning how to work. They're also not over-specialized. Gonna be discussing that a little later. They also had mentors. I had a great science teacher in high school who turned me completely around and got me motivated to study. Now, Jane Goodall, at 5 years old, had to go out to the neighbor's hen house, figure out how the chickens laid their eggs. You see, that's observation. Observation's a really important part of science, and she also liked solitude. Okay, she was a good high school student, raised in a home full of books. Now, of course, in her era in England, girls became secretaries. Probably, you know, shorthand probably helped her out in the field. Her favorite books as a child were Dr. Doolittle, Tarzan, and the Jungle Book. And Dr. Leakey mentored her, even though he hired her originally to be a secretary. And then the rest is history. Super, super important, very talented career. Thomas Edison had childhood chemistry experiments. He was exposed to things like railroads and grain elevators. In fact, he almost drowned in the grain at a grain elevator. And he burned up the baggage car on a train. That did not make the railroads real happy. And he was raised in a home full of books. The other thing is, he had early work experience. Started, he was a newsboy, started his own paper, telegraph operator at age 14, learned how to work. This is a really important thing. And at autism meetings, where you've got half the kids are fully verbal, there's geeks and nerds. I went to college with a lot of geeks and nerds that own businesses. I also worked on designing cattle facilities. I designed a piece of equipment called the center track restrainer system for beef plants, where all the big plants have it. If you want to see that stuff, you can look up Beef Plant Video Tour by Temple Grandin, and I'm not going to play that now. But I worked with a lot of heavy millwrights, building us big, complicated Cargill plants, and some of those were on the spectrum. Own metal fabrication companies. And now that geeky kid's getting addicted to video games, not learning how to work. Not a good scene. And Thomas Edison asked lots of questions constantly. I used to ask lots of questions. You know, right over here on Memorial Drive, right next to the church, right near Harvard Yard, my grandfather and grandmother lived there. And my grandfather was the co-inventor of the autopilot for airplanes, John C. Purvis. And I used to ask him endless science questions. Why do tides go in and out? Why is grass green? Ask him all these questions. And that was something I really liked to do. Edison memorized all kinds of streets. Steven Spielberg, again, got exposed to movies early with his little Super 8 camera. That probably saved him. And then he got into a really important internship. You see, that's important. And Musk, who you all know was developed PayPal, he got into an internship with the bank because he kept calling up the vice president. Then one of the vice presidents just said, well, they'd have lunch with him. That's going in the back door. And Steven said, movies saved me from shame. And Elon Musk loved Hitchhiker's Ride to the Galaxy. And he was a compulsive reader. And a local bookstore would let him sit in there and read books. Again, exposure to books and learning. He also was exposed to skilled trades with his father's engineering projects. He also did extensive international travel. I found some of my very, very first trips that I did overseas looking at cattle stuff. So totally changed some of my perspective. You know, it's a big world out there. And at age 11, he received a computer, learned programming, and he's just old enough to avoid the video game addictions. That's a really big problem today. I'm seeing too many talented kids getting addicted to video games, and they're ending up on Social Security with an autism diagnosis. They're not ending up in the gaming industry, and they have never learned to work. And he made homemade rockets. I did Model Rocket Club when I was a child. I did all kinds of hands-on things. I spent hours experimenting with little bird kites, and I'd fly them behind my trike. And I had to do a lot of different designs to make them work, and I did little wingtips, just like what the jet airplanes have today. Hard worker. Elon Musk tried to lease a store to open up a video game store. Of course, he was too young to do that. He also did really grubby manual labor in his 20s. And then the internship at the bank in Nova Scotia, and he did complete college. Now, he wants to make rockets really cheap, so he's using car wash valves with different seals. When that rocket exploded, I go, wait a minute, did the car wash valve seals fail? Last night, I spent half an hour online to find the latest information on it. It may not have been a car wash valve. It may have been a tank that failed. I'm not sure. Or did they just forget to switch out a car wash seal? Because they had to switch out the seals. You know, sometimes you can get too cheap. But I think it's more likely pushing and rushing too much. That's why Samsung got in trouble with their phone. They wanted to beat Apple. Well, you can't be staying up all night, and batteries is one place where you don't skimp on quality control. That's for sure. Okay, these are some interesting books that I've read on creative genius. A lot of these creative geniuses do not complete a standard conventional educational path. They also do not over-specialize. This is some information I got out of two books, Creativity and Science, The Logics of Genius and the Zeitgeist, and The Geography of Genius. Some very, very interesting books. Now, this is one of my most important slides. This is the different kinds of minds. I'm a photorealistic visual thinker. Everything I think about is in a picture. And when I was young, I used to think everybody thought in pictures. Then you have the pattern thinker. This is a spatial visualizer. This is your mathematician. They think in patterns, not in pictures. Now, one of the problems with photorealistic visual thinking is I absolutely couldn't do algebra. Didn't make any sense. I'm seeing too many smart kids getting totally screened out with the algebra requirement. They're not allowed to take geometry or statistics. And what saved me when I was in college in 1967, finite math was the educational fad of the time. And it was probability, matrices, and statistics. And with a ton of tutoring, I was able to get through that. But we're screening out all kinds of brilliant visual thinkers. And we shouldn't be screening them out. Well, I just found out that you've got a whole bunch of publications on the Fukushima nuclear power plant. And when I found out why that burned up, it was beyond my imagination how they could let that happen. I can't design a nuclear reactor. But I worked with a company called Schmeckle Construction. Heavy millwrights build heavy construction, and they could have put seawater on that thing really, really easily. There's no way, if I had been drawing up the plans for the concrete, that I would have put all that emergency equipment in a non-waterproof basement. Simple, watertight doors. But what I've learned about the mathematical thinking is they don't see the water going in there. Okay. How about the self-driving car? I want a manual off switch that disconnects all computer stuff, a manual brake so I can stop it, and enough steering so I can get it off the road that's non-electronic. That's something it needs to have in case somebody hacks it. And then you have the verbal thinker, person who thinks totally verbal. Education is an area where the verbal thinker, I think, is totally taken over. And we're screening out a lot of smart kids that we need. You know, what would happen to some of those kids today? I can tell you where they're at. They're addicted to video games. And then you have some people that are much more of an auditory thinker. And most so-called normal people, they are mixtures of the different kinds of thinking. Now, there's some stuff going on in education today that I think is just crazy. About just a few weeks ago, I had dinner with a regular education third grade teacher who got in trouble for teaching borrowing and subtraction, old-fashioned way that we are taught. Now, I'm not suggesting throwing out some of the new ways of teaching math, but why don't we teach both? I also had a snack with a whole bunch of college students, again, within the last month, that could not find the area of a circle. Boy, I can tell you, I designed hydraulic and pneumatic equipment. You've got to be able to find the area of a circle. And I was teaching them how to do this. You know, how about just practical math? Like how many, what's the area of this floor here from the irregular shape to figure out how many boards you need to do this floor? Just regular, just practical things like that. Use a variety of different methods. And then, if you want wondering whether these different kinds of minds really are true, in my book, The Autistic Brain, you can skip the genetic stuff, just read the second half. Second half of The Autistic Brain, I discuss the research that shows that the different kinds of minds, the photorealistic visual thinker like me, and the mathematical pattern thinker are really real. They are different types of thinking. See, my mind works like Google for images. You put in a keyword, I get images. The HBO movie showed that absolutely perfectly. Like, I was listening to that wonderful description of the owl and what it ate. I was seeing all of that stuff. That was a great talk. I really liked that talk. Boy, it painted me a picture of how the owl lives. Okay, Musk, he could take a whole lot of information and integrate it together. You see, it's non-linear. He had a lot of visual thinking traits. He could do programming, but according to the book, and I've read the book really, really carefully, probably not the top-notch programmer. You see, the photorealistic visual thinker and the more mathematical mind, they're kind of opposites. They use different parts of the brain, and that's been shown in PET scan work. And I'm going to show you more why we got to have our visual thinkers. Whether you're building a Cargill or a Tyson plant, or you're building a nuclear reactor, or you're just making a consumer electronic product, you need all the different kinds of minds. And he could take in lots of information. What do I do on airplanes? I read. New York Times, Wall Street Journals, Business Weeks, Science Magazines, Wired, Time, Newsweek, Atlantic, New Yorker. I read. While other people play games, I read. That's what I like to do on planes. I'm planning to read the New York Times on the way home today. Okay, the interesting thing is Thomas Edison was not a mathematician. I think he was more my kind of mind. And he goes, I can always hire some mathematicians, but they can't hire me. That's a quote right out of the book, and I've got the correct credit there on the slide. Another thing I think is a problem is over-specialization. You know, I was at a plant science meeting. I always get asked, how can you justify eating meat? Well, I've been learning little baby crop science. And about 2 years ago, our department, our animal science department, had a plant scientist come to our cattle meeting. And I learned something I didn't know before. The very best soils, you know, right around Illinois and Iowa, was created by herds of grazing animals. The grazing animals are part of the land. We got to start getting the grazing animals back with the land. And we have huge amounts of land in the world that cannot be cropped. There's not enough groundwater, like the outback of Australia, big parts of the West. All right. And when I was at the poster session, talked to the plant scientists a lot about crop rotation. We need to be doing a lot more of that, also to prevent plant diseases. Several researchers were telling me that their very best A-plus super honors graduate students had no creativity. So they told me. Here's an example of over-specialization in medicine. These are cases, I'm getting older, you know, so I got to complain about my sciatic nerve and a bunch of other problems I've got. So they started complaining about their problems, and we're having a discussion about, you know, older people, all stuff going wrong with them. And this poor lady had a whole lot of nasty symptoms, and went to the lupus specialist, top medical center. I'm not going to say where it is. I don't want to embarrass them. This is within the last year. This is not something from 10 years ago. This is within the last year. The lupus specialist was doing hive biopsies. I'm not kidding. Hive biopsies? She had a rash. And she was down in Mexico, and the old Mexican doctor says, well, you just need to take some Benadryl. Well, it turned out she was allergic to an ingredient in one of her medications. Got rid of the medication, took some Benadryl, she was fine. Hive biopsies? Really? And then another lady I was talking to that I had a meal with, she just felt really horrible all over, and she did a whole bunch of expensive bone scans, really run up a whole lot of bills. She had untreated Lyme disease. And then as soon as she got on the antibiotics, she was a whole lot better. And I know another person who had hepatitis C. He's getting cured. He's getting a magic drug. We work in construction. And one thing you learn when you work in construction, I was in that industry for 20 years. If you don't have parts, we'd pick the horn up. Well, he slid the mouse around, and the drug is not going to cost $72,000. We're in construction, and we're going to get the drug. We got the drug. Very, very good source, because we work in construction, and we find things we need. It's just that simple. And don't get me started on the EpiPen. I think it's unconscionable. Unconscionable. What's going on with that? Unconscionable and jacking up the price of generics to like several hundred dollars. They ought to cost $10, not several hundred dollars. Just totally terrible. Okay, I read this when I was in graduate school, a quote from Isaac Asimov, the science fiction writer. A degree is the first step down a ruinous highway. You don't want to waste it, so you go on into doctoral research. And you end up a thoroughgoing ignoramus on everything in the world except for one subdivisional sliver of nothing. And when I was at the plant science meeting in the poster room, they said, yeah, I had this one postdoc. He knew all about one crystal, and that's all he knew about. All right. Well, one of the receptions here, somebody told me that robots are going to replace people to fix power lines. I'm going, BS. I'll tell you what robots are going to replace. Super specialized doctors. That's who artificial intelligence is going to replace. Super specialized areas of knowledge. All right. Pick this up in The Economist while sitting on a plane. AI expert system reads x-rays better than doctors, but it cannot do the secretary's job. You see, because that is much more variable. Now, the thing that's interesting is I read about artificial intelligence. It works by bottom up. You train the program with specific examples. Expert doctors do this of x-rays with different types of problems. It's trained with specific examples. That is bottom-up thinking. That's the same way people with autism think. They're bottom-up thinkers. Verbal thinkers are top-down. Education's gone crazy on grandiose top-down stuff that doesn't work. A bottom-up thinker works like an epidemiologist. An epidemiologist figures out a food poisoning case by saying, okay, somebody ate something here, they ate some lettuce over here, they ate this over here, and then you piece the pieces together and you figure out that, you know, they ate lettuce from a certain place that had E. coli on it. You see, that's the bottom-up approach. Concepts are formed with specific examples. Top-down thinkers tend to overgeneralize. And really good managers have got to get in the field. Let's take United Airlines, for example. World's worst on-time record. They got a new CEO. And all of a sudden, things changed. Oscar went out to the airport and found that trying to squeeze one more leg out of that plane was a bad idea. It's better off to just have extra time in the schedule, and then the planes are in the correct place the next day, because you have a thunderstorm, then the plane's stuck in Boise instead of being in Chicago. Also, they found out that hiring the cheapest ground operations contractor is a big mistake. And now I'm seeing a picture of my plane sitting out there for 20 minutes because you didn't have a guy to do this to bring a plane in. And they didn't have any staff around there. And then they hired a new contractor, their name's Simplicity, and they put their name on their vest, they're proud of it. Huge improvement in ground operations. I mean, it's obvious. You know, I come out of construction, so I'm interested in those sort of things. But he had to go out in the field to find out that you can't load and unload a great big plane in 20 minutes. It's impossible. Your bottleneck's the baggage conveyor. That's your bottleneck. And that's the same. We have lots of conveyors in the meat industry, and that's how you figure out capacities for things. Okay, what would happen to me today? I had no speech until age 4. I probably would get into a really good childhood early intervention program. That's something they're doing better. You got little kids that are not talking. Once you rule out deafness, you got to do 20 hours a week of one-on-one teaching. I got that. Being taught turn-taking games, you know, turn-taking in conversations. Now, I was severely autistic at age 4, and I'd be a prime candidate for video game addiction. What little bit of video game playing I've done, I go, this is a drug. I can't touch this. Absolutely cannot touch this. The other horrible mistake the schools have made is they've taken out all the hands-on stuff, cooking, sewing. Oh, girls were taught sewing. I loved sewing. In fourth grade, I had a wonderful little Singer sewing machine. Loved it. Loved making things. Kids aren't making things any day, anymore. They're not making stuff anymore. And a lot of the millwrights I worked with, really smart people building complicated stuff, they took welding in high school. It saved them. I know a guy who's dyslexic, ADHD, bad stutter, horrible student, took welding, owns a metal fabrication company. Can't tell you what he makes because I got to keep some confidentiality. So kids are not learning hands-on things. Hands-on things teach practical problem solving. We've got a severe lack of that. Also, they're not getting out and working. They get an autism diagnosis, ADHD, or some other diagnosis, because you got to have a diagnosis now to get any services in the school, and they're getting handicap mentality. I'm finding some moms can't let go. My mother knew how to stretch me, get me doing new things, starting out with being party hostess. I saw a 13-year-old kid the other day, fully verbal, looked like a guy that should be going to Silicon Valley, and he had never shopped, gone into a store, bought something, checked it out at the check stand, bring back the change in the receipt. He had never done that. I was doing that at age 7. So you've got to stretch. You're getting a handicap mentality. I tell parents and teachers, don't chuck them in the deep end of the pool, but you gotta stretch them. So when I get a chance to try out all the new brain scanning equipment, I go try it out. It's fun to play around with state-of-the-art equipment. And I have parents ask me all the time, do I need to get my kid brain scanned? No, because you know, in the classroom, the stuff shows up. I got a big visual thinking circuit. But when I was in third grade, my ability to draw showed up. And my mother always encouraged that. And instead of just drawing the same stuff over and over again, she encouraged me to draw lots of different things. Take that thing the kid's interested in and expand on it. He likes trains, that's a real common one. Let's read about trains. Let's do mathematics with trains. Just broaden it out. Use that specialized interest. Yeah, I got a real big one, top 20%. Visual thinking circuit goes all the way from where the graphics files are stored to the frontal cortex. Give me a keyword, and the pictures come up. All right, here's the wrecked math department. Right down there, you can see the left parietal area is trashed. Really wrecked the algebra department. I don't have a working memory. But you don't need working memory to design things. Algebra, oh yeah, I would have been one of those kids screened out. Last year, I was down in New Jersey, and I talked to a girl who was not allowed to take biology in the community college because she hadn't had algebra. And then I talked to a lady just here that worked as a president of a community college, and she had students that had done everything except the algebra requirement. Why not let them take geometry or take trig or take statistics or something else? You know, with tutoring, I was able to do those kinds of math. But working memory is a problem. So if they have to do certain tasks, give them a pilot's checklist. But you don't need working memory to design stuff. Okay, what helped me get ahead in the meat industry? The meat industry had no academic barrier of entry. And there was a lot of quirky people that worked on building things in the meat industry. Just took that welding class or took that drafting class. And if you watched the movie, you probably saw the infamous Scottsdale Feed Yard. Well, when I went to Scottsdale Feed Yard, I drove by the Motorola plant. Now, I knew I could never work there. I would just sort of dream about things they did in the Motorola plant. I was saved by the finite math class. Absolutely saved. And how did I get into college when I had horrible high school grades? My mother talked the dean of Franklin Pierce College, which was only 2 years old at the time, up in Ringe, New Hampshire, to take me in. And at this point, I had decided to study. And when I failed my first math quiz with Mr. Dion, wonderful Mr. Dion, brand new math teacher, he tutored me in his office. But I did something about it when I trashed the first quiz. Now I guess it's called self-advocacy. Back in those days, it was called get tutored in math before you fail a course. And I managed to get B as in beautiful both semesters with a ton of work. And I graduated second in my class. And Mr. Carlock, my wonderful science teacher, I was still visiting with him on weekends. Now, what helped me in my childhood journey? Educated family. Mother read books to us. We were brought up with an absolute love of books and literature. She'd read parts of Dickens, and then she'd skip the boring parts. My art ability was always nurtured. I spent hours making kites and helicopters. And you know what? I went back to recreate one of those kites, and they were not that easy to recreate. I had a disc kite, and I had a bird kite with a jet wingtip. So I got my bird kite to work with an Office Max file folder. But I still can't get my disc kite to work, because I can't get the same rough surface art paper. And I know the rough surface changes the aerodynamics. I've got to experiment some more to get my disc kite to fly. So replicating them as a grown-up's not been that simple. And Mother read to us. The other thing I learned from making all these kites is you can make mistakes. A lot of these kids today, they're scared to death to make a mistake. They'll destroy work that's not absolutely perfect. You know, a lot of my kites didn't work. Then I just had to try something else. You can learn from mistakes. My favorite books as a child was a book about favorite inventors. I can't find the cover of the original one, but this is one, a very nice one, a nice book about inventors, very similar to the one I had. I loved reading about Thomas Edison and the sewing machine, Elias Howe, and the cotton gin and the wheat reaper, and Black Beauty, both the grown-up version, which Mother read to us, and my childhood version. Those were my favorite books. So again, this gets back to this early exposure, really important. Okay, I got interested in cattle because I was exposed to them at 15. So how did a girl who lived outside of Boston in Dedham, with a grandfather that lives in Memorial Drive looking out in the Charles River, get into cattle? Mother got remarried when I was 14. That brought a ranch into the family. It was my stepfather's sister. See, sometimes it's just luck. And mother, I was going to the Hampshire Country School, boarding school. Mother wanted to get me out doing some new things because she don't want to get me too set in my ways. And I went out to the ranch, and I ended up loving it. I was afraid to go at first. She gave me a choice. I could go for a week, or I could go all summer. Not going was not going to be one of the choices. She knew just how hard to push me. And when I was away at the Hampshire School, I did very little studying. I learned carpentry, I learned roofing, and riding, and horse barn management, all kinds of things like that. And I think Mr. Patey, the headmaster, realized I was learning how to work. But I did have two good subjects, biology I studied in, and writing. And I'm appalled at the writing skills of some of the students today. I learned how to write because in fourth grade and middle school, the teachers red marked up my work, copy edited my work. I guess that's not politically correct today, but that's how I learned how to write. Some kids are going to learn diagramming sentences. That's not for me. What taught me was old-fashioned copy editing by the teacher. And they're not supposed to do that today in some schools, which I think is just ridiculous because my writing skills were decent. All right, here's my work experience. Sewing job at 13 that mother just got for me in the neighborhood. Saved up some money, bought some really ugly striped shirts that my mother hated, that I loved, and she'd lose them in the laundry for me. And that reminds me, because I'm an associate thing, so that reminds me about an article about the wife that would lose her husband's cargo pants in the laundry. And he was not happy about that. Horse stall cleaning at 15, roofing at 16. I'm not suggesting roofing to parents today. I'm suggesting shopping. I'm suggesting maybe editing some video at the church office just down the street. Real simple, harmless stuff. I was painting signs. You see, how did I get my business started on designing corrals? I started out one project at a time, and then I'd write about it. I couldn't afford advertising. I'd write about it in the farm magazines, and I was doing some freelance carpentry work. And I wasn't over-specialized. Here are some college classes I loved. Animal behavior. I was super lucky that a retired professor, and I think he was from Harvard, Dr. Tom Evans, came up once a week to teach the animal behavior class, classical ethology. This was during the time of total B.F. Skinner, everything's operant conditioning. Well, in Dr. Evans's class, there was a lot of hardwired instinctual behavior. Experimental psychology and optical illusions. I got interested in that because in high school I saw a science movie. Got me interested, and I found out I loved the English literature class. And I'm going, why do I take this stupid course in English literature? I loved it because the teacher explained what the different authors emotionally were trying to get across. It was one of my favorite classes, and I had practical skills in carpentry and hands-on. And high school mentors, I had my science teacher, and then Ann out at the ranch. I actually built that gate, was shown in the movie that you could open up from a car. And they show how I figured out the leverage from the heating vent. You know, I went and looked up some old patents for heating vents. And the one that I had was so basic, I couldn't find a patent for it. And then learning driving, learning how to type. These are things that Ann taught me. Okay, yes, I was weird. So how did I impress potential clients? By showing a portfolio of my work. I learned to sell my work by showing off my drawings. Good, we got a fantastic computer that didn't corrupt this picture. Because presentation does matter. But I would show people my drawings. And they go, you did that? And then I had a very nice brochure, nothing about autism on this. And how did I sell cargo? Because I designed the front end of every cargo beef plant in the US and Canada. because I sent this brochure and I sent probably that same drawing I showed there along with a bunch of photographs and a couple of articles to Bill Fielding, the head of Cargill. 30-second wow. And I'll have a mom come up to me and say, my kid's a great artist. I said, do you have his art on your phone? Where's your portfolio? Sell him some jobs. See, I kind of had the work ethic thing right from the beginning. Well, and then I show a bunch of nice pictures of things I designed. That's the cattle coming up to the original dip vat, which they duplicated for the movie. I love the fact the movie had my real drawings in it. And the title of the movie had an animated shop drawing of my center track restrainer system that was actually used to build a real job. And for someone who's into building things, I thought that was just super cool. And there's another one of my jobs. Just show off the nice pictures. You want the 30-second wow. Now, when I was young, I thought I could fix it all with engineering. If I could just build the perfect thing, everything would be fine. I had a few clients that did things right. That was kind of the light at the end of the tunnel. Some people really handled cattle right. Half my clients tore up equipment and wrecked it. Then, in 1999, I was hired by the McDonald's Corporation to teach their food safety auditors how to audit animal welfare at slaughter plants. And I came up with a very simple scoring system. 5 things that you measure. Real simple, simple stuff like traffic rules. Percentage you shot dead with the captive bolt on the first shot. How many fell down during handling. How many were mooing and their heads off during handling. How many you put the electric prodder on. And they have to be 100% dead before you cut anything off of them. 5 simple outcome variables. Traffic rules for slaughter plants. And when I'm trying to get people to think about the critical control point approach, what 3 traffic rules would you enforce if you could only enforce 3 traffic rules to get maximum public safety? Okay, somebody give me an... only allowed to enforce 3 of them for maximum public safety. What would they be?
No texting.
What?
No texting.
Yeah, no texting, yep, we have to add that one. Yeah, that would be one, but what? Speed, yep, I'd have that. Speed. No, not turns. That might be like number 6. What?
Stop and red light.
Stop and red light, yep. But now, what I find when I do this exercise, you've left out the 800-pound gorilla. The gorilla of all gorillas. I find when I do this exercise, and I've done it many times, gets left out. That's drunk driving. Drunk driving, duh. Yeah, that simple. And the police measure the speed. They can measure how much alcohol is in your on your breath. They measure it. But for some reason, the drunk driving, usually it comes up last, and I have to really kind of urge people. Now, what this is all about here is I was hired by the USDA in 1996 to do a survey, and only 30% of the plants could shoot 95% dead on the first shot. You know why? Busted equipment. Broken. Broken equipment. This is management. You can only fix half the stuff with engineering. When I was young, I thought I could fix everything with engineering. Only can fix half. And then the first thing we went in there and make them fix all the broken stuff. Busted side adjusters on my center track restrainer. Broken hydraulics on my center track restrainer. Fix all this broken stuff. And then they had to go in and put in non-slip flooring. The other thing we did is we worked with lighting. Cattle don't like the dark. So you put a light up in just the right place. And they'll go in. You can look all that stuff up on Grandin.com. I got videos online. Out of 75 pork and beef plants, only 3 had to build an expensive new front end. Only 3. Everybody else we fixed with the simple things. Repairs, lighting, put up a solid panel so they didn't see people walking by. Just simple stuff. And they very quickly got up to a very high level. The average first shot stunning score in 2015 is like 99.7. I mean, they can't get any better than that. And then the one they missed, they immediately reshooted. And it's automatic failed audit if you hang it on the line live. Boom, you're gonna fail the audit. Real simple, 5 outcome scores. But I find that people that think in words, they wanna make all this vague stuff, like handle them properly. I don't know what, that'd be like saying to the police, are people driving at the prudent, correct speed? No, there's a sign there with a number, they measure it, and they usually give you a 5 mile an hour fudge factor. All right, let's look at who builds stuff in heavy commercial construction. Heavy industrial, who does what? I'm from the visual thinking department. What do? The draftsman, and they usually stick them in the basement in there with all the cable trays in the service corridor, doesn't get enough respect. He lays out the whole entire plant. All the complicated conveyor systems. If it was the airport, he's the one that's going to lay out all the conveyors that are underneath the airport. It's not the degreed engineer. The millwrights in the shop, the weird guys in the shop, who are playing video games now instead of fixing Cargill plants, they invent all the really intricate, interesting mechanical engineering stuff. They invent the new stuff. And the degreed engineer, he'll do the more abstract stuff. Boilers, refrigeration, steam pipes, soil compaction, roof truss calculation, those sort of things. But the thing is, you need the whole entire team. They are all important. And the plants right now are going crazy because they can't hire industrial mechanics. The trucking companies are going nuts right now. They can't get diesel mechanics. You think robots are going to fix all these trucks? That's nonsense. Yeah, they might be some artificial intelligence on diagnosing some of the problems. But they need these people. Don't underestimate what they can do. I worked with a bunch of them. Pretty sure they're on the spectrum. Okay, let's just finish up talking about some stuff about science. You get the more verbal thinker or mathematical thinker, they say you got to have a controlled experiment to do science. I used to fight with my thesis advisor about that. And I'd go, Stan, what about astronomy? What about epidemiology? What's the control group for the Hubble Space Telescope? Do we point it at the ground? Yeah, I guess it was a spy satellite at one time, so maybe they did point it at the ground. But epidemiology, which is a science, and astronomy are observation. And what Jane Goodall did was observation. Observation's a really important part of science. Doesn't get enough credit. And it's been an interesting journey for me to learn how my visual thinking was different. When I was in my 20s and 30s, I didn't know that other people didn't think in pictures the way I did. And I could see mistakes. You know, like the Fukushima nuclear power plant thing, how could you not put in waterproof doors? And I learned that the mathematical mind doesn't see the water filling up the basement and drowning the electrically operated equipment, emergency equipment, that you needed for cooling. That's just totally obvious to me. But you need the different minds working together. And the first step is realizing that there are different ways that people think. And I've collaborated on some very, very good research. I worked with a lady named Camille King, fabulous dog trainer. She observed that dogs get gray the same way the presidents do, and it's the anxious, stressed dogs that get gray. We had a great statistician. My part of the work was to figure out the photographs to use for judging the different degrees of gray, so you'd get inter-observer reliability. I do the methods part of the experiment. But you need all the different kinds of minds. Let's take the iPhone. Steve Jobs was an artist. You know, that's why you don't need a PhD in engineering to operate the phone. Because an artist made the interface, the engineers had to make the insides work. See, this is where you need the different kinds of minds working together. And I just want to finish up that I'm really worried that today's educational system is screening out a lot of kids. And you need these kinds of thinkers. Because right now, there's 2 million people right now with the hurricane that have no electrical power. And the quirky guys are going to go out there and put those wires back up. And they're hiring right now. Utilities, they're hiring. Okay, now, what I want to do right now is do questions. This is the part I really like.